Welcome to part one of the cardiovascular system. This part is going to focus on cardiac anatomy and physiology as well as assessment. Our objectives for cardiac are the student will describe the cardiac anatomy and physiology, the student will perform a cardiac assessment, the student will differentiate the signs and symptoms of right-sided and left-sided heart failure, and the student will recognize the signs and symptoms of hypertension. The heart is the pump of our body. It squeezes and relaxes over and over to pump our blood all over our body. The heart is made up of three layers, the endocardium, myocardium, and epicardium. The endocardium is the innermost layer and it lines the chambers and valves of the heart. The myocardium is the muscle layer of the heart and it does all the pumping work. The epicardium is the outermost layer. Covering the heart is the pericardium, which is like a sac around the heart, and it has a layer of fluid acting as a lubricant to reduce the friction, just like our lungs have. This fluid space is called the pericardial space. The heart has four chambers, two atria on the top of the heart and two ventricles on the bottom of the heart. We can divide the atria and ventricles up into right side and left side. The right side of the heart takes the deoxygenated blood from the body and pumps it into the lungs to get oxygenated. From the lungs, the oxygenated blood goes to the left side of the heart, where it gets pumped out to the rest of the body. Dividing up all four of these chambers are valves. The arterioventricular valves, or AV valves, separate the atria from the ventricles. On the right side, we have the tricuspid valve, and on the left side, we have the mitral valve. Then we have the pulmonic valve that separates the right side of the heart and the lungs. On the left side of the heart, we have the aortic valve that separates the left side from the aorta, leading back into circulation. The myocardium has its own blood supply called coronary arteries. The myocardium never stops working, so it needs a lot of oxygen. The coronary arteries supply fresh oxygenated blood to the myocardium nonstop. In addition to the structures of the heart and the coronary arteries, the heart has its own electrical conduction system. The heart has the ability to generate and transmit its own electricity to stimulate the contraction of the myocardium. This conduction system is very dependent on having balanced electrolytes like potassium, magnesium, and you're going to learn a lot more about cardiac conduction in later blocks. The cardiac cycle is everything that occurs from the beginning of one heartbeat to the beginning of the next one. Each cardiac cycle has three phases, diastole, atrial systole, and ventricular systole. Diastole is when the heart is at rest. It's not doing any movement. All four chambers are relaxed and the AV valves are open and the semilunar valves are closed. This is when ventricular filling occurs. At the end of diastole, the atria start to contract, causing atrial systole, which ejects the remaining blood into the ventricles. This begins ventricular systole, where the AV valves close, the ventricles contract, and the semilunar valves open up, allowing the ventricles to pump the blood out of the heart, either to the lungs or to the body. The number of times a heart will do this cycle is dependent on the heart rate. In addition to all of this, there are pressure changes inside each chamber that play a role in the cardiac cycle, and you'll definitely learn about those pressure changes in later blocks. Able to function. Male and female hearts have some significant differences, and female hearts are smaller than males, which means they have smaller coronary arteries. This makes women at higher risk for coronary artery related disorders. And women tend to get these disorders at a younger age than males due to the hormonal changes in their bodies. As people age, the conduction system starts to lose some function, which leads to slower heart rates and higher risk of cardiac rhythm issues. The size of the heart starts to increase, which we call hypertrophy, which reduces how much blood the chambers can hold, which affect how much oxygenated blood gets out into the body. The myocardium gets weaker with this hypertrophy, the valves start to get stiff, and they don't open as easily. All of this makes it much harder for older adults to recover after activity, stress, or illness. Now we're going to discuss how we assess the cardiovascular system. The cardiovascular system affects every body system, so when we do an assessment, we may be assessing many body systems, and we're definitely going to be asking a lot of questions. First, we need to get a thorough health history that includes family and genetic history, as there are many genetic abnormalities that could be affecting our patient. We also need to ask about cultural and social factors, such as diet, recreational tobacco, and alcohol use, and their views about medical care, because all of these can affect when a person might see a provider about cardiovascular related issues. We need to ask about the medications they are taking, both prescribed and over-the-counter, including supplements. We also need to ask about modifiable and non-modifiable risk factors. Modifiable risk factors are risk factors people can change, like smoking, diet, exercise, stress, sleep, and treating diseases like diabetes and hypertension. Smoking, diet high in fat and sodium, lack of exercise, high stress levels, and not treating diabetes and hypertension all can have significant negative effects on the cardiovascular system. Non-modifiable risk factors are things they can't change, like gender, age, and genetics. We can't change those risks, and we have to take those risks into account when we're assessing our patient. Other questions we need to ask are about their elimination patterns, especially urination, as kidneys require certain blood pressure to filter out urine. This also includes any recent weight gain or loss. We also need to ask about their roles and relationships in their lives. It sounds really funny, but when people have cardiac issues, they may be too fatigued to live a normal life, so they stay home. Another thing we need to ask them about, especially men, is their sexuality. Having an erection requires a certain blood pressure, and if their blood pressure is too low, the blood going to the penis may cause chest pain. The act of sex is also very physical, so that could lead to chest pain as well. When we're doing a physical assessment for cardiovascular, we need to start with their general appearance. How do they look? Are they in distress? How is their skin coloring all over? And how is their breathing? We need to assess their vital signs, paying close attention to their pulse, blood pressure, and pulse ox. We may also need to do orthostatic blood pressures to see if they have any complaints of lightheadedness or dizziness. We need to assess for JVD and all of their pulses to see if they're present. While we're at that, we need to assess for edema. We need to auscultate their heart for any heart sounds that should not be present, like murmurs, S3 and S4. We need to auscultate their lung sounds, as heart and lungs go hand in hand, and it's very common to have heart issues that cause lung issues. We need to ask about chest pain or discomfort, including the upper body. Some heart issues can cause jaw and neck pain, as well as arm pain. We need to ask if they ever felt like their heart was racing or skipping beats. This is called palpitations. We need to ask about any shortness of breath they may have, any dyspnea, orthopnea, or cough. We also need to ask about any unusual fatigue, dizziness, syncope, which is fainting, or changes in level of consciousness. Lack of oxygen to the brain from hypoxia or hypotension can cause any of these symptoms. One nice thing about cardiovascular system is there's a lot of laboratory tests we can do to help us figure out what's going on. We have lab tests to screen for coronary artery disease risk, heart attacks, and heart failure. The first lab I want to discuss is cardiac biomarkers. Cardiac biomarkers tell us if myocardial cells are not receiving enough blood and oxygen, which could lead to a heart attack. There are three cardiac markers: creatine kinase, CK, creatine kinase myocardial band, CKMB, and troponin. These three lab studies, along with a 12-lead ECG, help us determine if the patient is having a heart attack. Next, we have brain or beta type natriuretic peptide, or BNP. This is a neurohormone that helps regulate blood pressure and fluid volume. It's secreted from the ventricles in response to too much fluid, and it helps us determine if someone's in heart failure, how bad their heart failure is, and if it's getting better or worse. C-reactive protein is a blood test we can do to check for inflammation in the body. While it isn't cardiac specific, it can help us determine if the patient is at risk for developing cardiovascular disease from too much inflammation in the body. Homocysteine is an amino acid that's linked to cardiovascular disease because too much of it can damage the lining of the arteries and promote blood clot formation. Lipid profiles help check a patient's HDL, LDL, and triglyceride counts, all of which are fat and cholesterol in the blood, and those put a person at risk for cardiovascular disease. Other labs we want to check for someone who may have cardiovascular issues are blood chemistry levels, like our electrolytes and kidney functions, a CBC, and our coagulation studies like PTINR and PTT. One important and frequently used diagnostic tool for cardiac issues is an electrocardiogram, or ECG, and you might hear people call it EKG. An ECG takes a picture of the heart electrical conduction system, telling us how the conduction is working in the heart. There are different ways we can use ECGs. One is to do a 12-lead ECG, which gives us a great in-depth snapshot of what the heart is doing at that moment in time. The pink picture with the squiggly lines on it is what we would get from a 12-lead ECG. We use these to detect heart attacks and cardiac dysrhythmias. Another way we can use ECGs is continuous monitoring, where the person is hooked up to a cardiac monitor, like the picture of the man and the picture in the top right monitor. The continuous monitor then sends the electrical signals from the heart to the bedside monitor, like that picture in the top right, or even to a remote location. Continuous cardiac monitoring doesn't give us an in-depth information like a 12-lead ECG will, but it lets us see the heart continuously, beat by beat, whereas a 12-lead just gives us a snapshot in time. And you're going to learn a whole lot more about ECGs in Block 2 and again in Block 4. Echocardiography is a non-invasive ultrasound that we do on the heart. Echoes give us measurements on the ejection fraction or the amount of blood being pumped out of the heart. Echoes also give us the size, shape, and motion of the cardiac structures. They give us a great video of how well the heart is working during the cardiac cycle. Most echoes are done transthoracically, like the picture shown here, where we're using the ultrasound through the outside of the body. They use the ultrasound wand externally to see the heart. And if we need to get a more in-depth view of the heart, we can actually sedate the person and put a probe down the esophagus to get a transesophageal echocardiogram, which we call a TEE. These are not as common as transthoracic echoes, but because the probe is so close to the heart without any bone in the way, we get a lot greater detail and a lot more accurate measurements from a TEE. There's also a test we can do while we put the heart under stress, and we call this a cardiac stress test. There are two ways to do this. The first is a treadmill stress test. The person has heart monitors placed on their chest, as well as vital sign monitoring, and the treadmill is started. At time intervals, the intensity of the treadmill increases. It's usually the incline and not the speed. The person walks as long as they can until they have symptoms like chest pain, or until they meet their target heart rate. The provider then looks at all of the data received from the vital signs and the cardiac monitors to see if there are any conduction abnormalities or signs of lack of oxygen to the myocardium. If the person cannot tolerate any exercise, they can do a pharmacological stress test where they administer IV vasodilating medications that stress the heart, mimicking exercise. And this is the end of part one of cardiovascular.